You are about to go behind the scenes.
Action!
To witness the X-Files transformation from a hit TV series into a major motion picture. I'm Mitch Pileggi. Join me along with series creator Chris Carter, director Rob Bowman, and stars David Duchovny and Gillian Anderson for The Making of the X-Files Movie.
Scully?
Yeah?
Run!
Read a lot of reports of the supernatural and of alien abduction and UFO sightings, and I just imagine that there must be some branch of government, law enforcement, who deals with these things.
I'm Fox Mulder. This is Dana Scully. We're with the FBI. We'd like to ask you a few questions.
The premise of the X-Files is two FBI agents exploring the paranormal from two different biases, one a skeptic, one a believer.
The reason you're here, Agent Scully, is we want you to assist Mulder on these X-Files. You will write field reports on your activities, making your reports exclusively to this group.
Am I to understand that you want me to debunk the X-Files project, sir?
Agent Scully, we trust you'll make the proper scientific analysis.
X-Files is born of and has always been driven by Mulder's sense of wonder and his belief in the unbelievable.
Mulder, for the last 10 or 15 years, has believed that his sister was abducted by aliens when he was 12 and she was 8. He's kind of a very odd guy who's made a really odd choice with his life, which was, you know, in most people's eyes, kind of a stupid endeavor to devote all his energy to chasing UFOs.
So who did you take off to get stuck with this detail, Scully?
Actually, I'm looking forward to working with you. I've heard a lot about you.
Oh, really? I was under the impression that you were sent to spy on me.
The banter between Mulder and Scully is usually built around Mulder's taking them on a wild goose chase while Scully is looking for some proof or science to back it up.
Mulder, look out!
The evolution has just been the experiences.
The more time that they spend together, the more care they have for each other.
Scully!
But I believe that what we're looking for is in the X-Files. I'm more certain than ever that the truth is in there.
Had been going along, cruising along with the show, and it had gotten more and more successful through the years. And we had always said that we were making a little movie each week, and that was really the spirit in which the show was done on an episodic basis. And so I think the natural sort of extension of that, the idea sort of popped up that why don't we do a movie? And it had been something we tossed around, but we realized at the end of 5 years, it would be a great time to do a big event, something that would celebrate and reward the hardcore viewers who had been watching the show for, you know, since the beginning. The trick was to do a movie that wasn't just for X-Files fans, but appeal to the casual viewer or the non-watcher of X-Files.
You could walk into this film having never heard of the X-Files or never seen one and enjoy it, definitely. I mean, there's no special knowledge that you have to know. There's no secret password.
We were determined that this movie would make sense and be entertaining to people who had never seen The X-Files before. And that was sort of the litmus test for every scene, every idea that we put in that movie, that it had to make sense coming to it fresh. But at the same time, we wanted to reward the fans. We felt like they'd be expecting and deserved to see some answers to some of the mysteries that have been raised in the series over the last 5 years.
We've explored this mythology in so many different ways that it's time to get to some answers. And, you know, we've proven and disproven theories and conspiracies and guilty parties so many times that eventually we have got to show, you know, who's up to what and why they're doing it. And give the viewers and the new fans a great mystery with some sensational images and a Chris Carter script and a Mark Snow score, and do it all, you know, the best we've ever done it with 5 years of practice. And it seems to me that it's basically the coup de grace of all of our work today.
Trust no one, Mr. Mulder.
June, 1997. 4 years after the start of the series, filming began on the X-Files movie. To ensure the story remained a surprise, a certain amount of secrecy was necessary.
There were certain precautions taken. The script was printed on red paper, so it couldn't be Xeroxed. There was disinformation leaked all year long. And there was an ending that wasn't written until actually just a few weeks ago.
The movie begins with Mulder having a hunch.
Mulder, when a terrorist bomb threat is called in, the rational purpose of providing that information is to allow us to find the bomb.
Scully and Mulder are potentially going to be blamed for the death of some people in the bombing.
It begins with, why do we have these dead bodies and what killed them?
I can't tell you what killed this man. I'm not sure anybody else could claim to either.
Goes into what has been going on for the past 45, 50 years.
It's a global conspiracy with key players and the highest levels of power. It reaches into the lives of every man, woman, and child on this planet.
And you have conclusive evidence of this?
Yes.
The secrets are information that is about a government cover-up.
The truth is something you never guess.
You can't quit now. I need you on this.
Whoa! I'm already way past the point of common sense here.
They are on the biggest case of all time, up against obstacles they've never been up against before.
Over the last couple seasons especially, I think Mulder and Scully have grown together even more. I think as the more time that they spend together and the more times that they save each other's lives, the more respect they have, the more care they have for each other. And so that's basically continued pretty strongly over the past couple seasons. And so that's really where we find them. Again, is in this very productive, very respectful working relationship. And within the film, there are some opportunities for them to get a little closer in certain ways than they have in the series.
You kept me honest. You made me a whole person. I owe you everything. Scully, you owe me nothing.
There's a couple events take place where that brings them closer because of the nature of the situations that they're in the midst of, and so the audience will have an opportunity to see, you know, a hint more of just a different flavor of their relationship.
You know, the reason the pairing works is probably because they're two interesting characters in their own right.
You have Dana Scully, who is so strong and so intelligent and so independent, and Mulder, a man who is everybody's hero, that they are equals and that they can come together and work together hand in hand in a platonic relationship and have the love and the respect and the caring and be considered as equals by others.
I think that the most important thing for me about Mulder was the fact that he didn't care about what anybody else thought about what he was doing. So he had a real strength of, you know, like a screw you strength.
So how did the producers of the X-Files bring such well-established characters and conflicts to a much larger canvas?
We only wanted to go to the big screen if we could somehow deliver something bigger and more dynamic than we could do on the little screen. And the movie allows you to tell bigger stories on a bigger canvas and to do some very exciting visual storytelling.
A spectacle is what I was looking for, and this provides scope. We wouldn't be able to go to some place like this in the television series and to do a sequence like we've got planned here. So it really is a matter of size and of panorama.
Scully!
The movie is made up by many elements. One of those is Chris's script and the vision that Chris set forth 5 years ago.
Chris and the show have evolved and gotten much more sophisticated and much better as we've gone on.
Being the creator of the series and of these characters and of this film, he knows how he wants everything to feel, and the importance of every moment in the big scheme of things.
I wanted to exploit the visual tapestry that I thought that Chris and I were capable of. And he wrote this script knowing that I was going to direct it. He wrote it right to my strengths.
We had a chance to cast some movie stars in the movie, and we wanted to put people in who really fit the characters that we had written. And it just so happens that the people that I wrote the parts for really became available to us kind of miraculously.
We wanted to bring in people who we felt were part of the X-Files world. And it was a careful selection, painstaking, to find people who could play these roles who we felt lived inside of the X-Files world, and so that we were not sort of selling out because we had a larger palette, larger screen, no commercials, you know, the things that differ from the TV show. And I certainly was thrilled, jumped up and down, I think, a high five to Chris Carter when I found out that Martin Landau had signed to do it.
My name is Kurzweil. Dr. Alvin Kurzweil.
Am I supposed to know that name?
Old friend of your father's.
When Scully gets this mark,
making his feature film directorial debut is Rob Bowman, veteran of over 25 X-Files episodes.
Make sense?
Yeah.
As an actor, you know, it's very easy for me to relate to Rob because I've been doing it for almost 4 years now. I mean, we have a shorthand. He understands the way I work, and I understand the way he works.
Okay, in this scene, I want you to imagine you're a blues racer. All right, we're going to give you a moment.
Hey, you there?
I need a moment.
Okay, you there? Think of the POV.
Okay, let's go.
He knows exactly what a scene needs. He really knows how to work with actors. And he can get very specific about what needs to be shifted within a scene to help us get to where we need to be.
Jillian, when the front wheels hit, that's a good time to brace, because that's when it shakes the camera a lot. Looks good.
I can literally look at Jillian, and the way I say her name, she'll say, got it, I know what you want. David will say, have you got it? And I said, you know, I need one more, and he'll know exactly why I need one more. That allowed us more takes. It allowed us to get a little bit more done every day, and allows it, I thought, to explore the characters just a little bit further.
The first time I saw Dave and Jillian on a movie screen, they came on screen, and I was kind of startled. I had never seen them proportionally huge compared to what I'm used to seeing them. And there was a moment where I sort of had to shake myself, and then I looked at them and realized that they're going to, you know, be on the big screen, and they're going to be movie stars, and they've filled those bigger shoes, if you will, every bit as one might have hoped that they would.
This is weird, Mulder.
Very weird.
With this broader palette, the makers of the X-Files movie had the freedom to attempt more sophisticated action sequences and stunts, many of which stars David Duchovny and Gillian Anderson perform themselves.
Fans of the show will be familiar with the kind of obstacles that Mulder and Scully run into.
What is called upon us is more heightened than you usually find in the series.
Well, that's one of the things I like about the character is that, yeah, he's very cerebral, but, you know, he can get out there and jump on a train and, you know, run around and get beat up and do things like that. So I'm used to doing those kind of things. And on this, there's been a lot of physical stuff. There's been a lot of like climbing and a lot of jumping and running. There hasn't been any fighting. And I don't believe that I pull my gun in this show, which is good because when I pull it, I lose it, which is one of the jokes on the TV shows. Whenever I pull my gun, it's gone. Somebody takes it from me.
Making the X-Files movie proved to be far tougher on the film stars than they had anticipated.
It's a lot of lifting for David. There's a lot of falling for me.
And bruises and bangs and soreness and lack of sleep and all-nighters and the Mojave Desert and, you know, freezing sound stages.
It's completely human unfriendly.
The middle of June, you're in the soundstage, it's 29 degrees, you walk outside, it's 104 degrees. The crew is dropping like flies, they can't, they gotta be there every day.
When it's on the big screen, it's on a big screen. You have to go in fearless.
And cut!
God.
David, are you okay?
I got blood blisters all over my hands. See that?
I've never seen David or Jillian work harder, I can tell you that.
That's all fun to do. You know, that's just like, it's like playing a game. It's, as an actor, you know, it's a good rest from the harder work of actually acting. It's fun to go out and jump off a building. You know, that's actually the easy part.
For the film's dangerous helicopter sequences, the producers enlisted the talents of ace Hollywood aerial coordinator David Paris.
We were chased by helicopters at an altitude that was a little too low for my liking, or at least my hair's liking.
Scully! Talk to me, Scully!
Mulder and Scully are being chased by helicopters. They're running away from an area where they shouldn't have been. So they're in cornfields, which are dark, and the helicopters have got searchlights trying to find them.
To create a believable action sequence, you have to tie the actors, the principals, into the action in some way. And if you use stunt doubles, you can't quite do that. And it brings the audience into the picture in a way that I've always felt is important on The X-Files. Luckily, I've got Dave and Jillian, who are both young and athletic and also are game. They really like to get in and do this stuff.
Ready?
Yeah.
Come on.
Let's go.
You need not act in a scene like that. You know, it's loud and it's scary and it's windy and you're screaming. And, you know, that's all you have to do is actually just exist in that moment. So it takes care of like any other acting that you had to do. Basically, you're just trying to survive.
One of the more complicated scenes to create features the blowing up of a 25-story building.
I need this building evacuated and cleared out in 10 minutes.
Actors, they shoot, you know, a little bit, but bombs and explosions, they shoot for days.
The trick is to make sure you blow the heck out of everything you can and that you photograph it and you get every ounce of value out of it.
We're creating an explosion as if our bad guy has put in several hundred pounds or 1,000 pounds of a high explosive in this building. What will happen is when we initiate it, these will all be covered in debris, desks or whatever. You can see some desks here that will be coming out the windows, etc. There'll be a gas ball coming out, fireball coming out, approximately 40 or 50 feet. And then there'll be a dust cloud that comes out and follows it out. And we do have a stunt car that'll come around the corner. And then when we hit the impact, we have the car rigged so it looks like they received the shockwave and it'll actually raise up the back end of the car. It'll blow out the back window.
Because of the dangerous nature of the shot, stunt doubles for David and Jillian are used to coordinate the timing of the vehicle with the building explosion.
So when I see fire, I hit the button which gets our cannon shooting our car up in the air and also detonates the charge and blows the windows.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're getting very close now and I just want to clarify what we're doing. In talking with Paul, he said there may be some small bits of debris that could radiate out, so there could be some small elements coming out this direction. In case of an emergency, only our medical personnel will enter the set and extract any victims. If you're physically not working the shot or supporting this sequence, I need everybody on the other side of the bomb vehicle.
The filmmakers had only one shot to capture this very expensive explosion on film. As a result, 14 cameras placed at different angles were utilized for the take.
Action! That's a cut. Nobody move. Everybody safe and secure, please.
Fantastic.
Use 14 cameras on that explosion. Some were for visual effects composite shots, and others were just various angles of the explosion.
What was exciting about it was the intensity of it, I think, and knowing that there are 3, 4, 5, 6 cameras rolling at one time, getting different angles, different aspects of what's happening.
Step one of the process is complete. Now David and Jillian are integrated into the scene.
We're trying to create an interior shot of our heroes as the explosion occurs. So our test here is to create a fire cloud in the back as if it were the building blowing up so that it ties into our shot.
Fire test, here we go. 3, 2, 1.
You know, they're kind of like amusement park rides when you do scenes like that, because, you know, they've got the car up on hydraulics. And I always say, let's shoot the first take, because, you know, they want you to get used to the movement. But I don't want to be used to the movement, because, you know, if, God forbid, you're ever around a bomb that explodes, you don't get to say that. You know, can you just explode in my face so I can get used to what it's like? So, you know, you want that kind of first experience.
There are cars that are rigged with flames. There is the car that we're in, which is rigged to bounce. There is all of this extracurricular activity that's going on.
After the full scale and principal photography are complete, the process continues with a miniature and the aid of computer technology.
You've got a lot of miniature pieces that are designed to fall away from camera and fall apart, and as they fall apart, debris comes behind them. You're gonna get the impression that you're watching an entire building falling away because we choose the camera angle so that you see the mayhem happening within the frame.
Action! A lot of the things that we'll do further on in the process involves compositing of different elements. We're going to take the miniature that we see here, bring it into the computer, and get rid of all the blue that you see surrounding the miniature and combine it with research photography and actually take this building out of Los Angeles and place it in Texas.
We're putting a lot of pieces together, and they're coming from 4 or 5 different directions. But we're combining them to make it look like they all happened at the same moment and that it was a really spectacular explosion.
The X-Files series has been known to unleash some pretty terrifying creatures on its 2 stars. But for the movie, the producers came up with one of their most dangerous gambits yet.
The B sequence, the challenge of that was that we were going to be working with 300,000 live stinging bees, and how is it that you do that for days on end without getting everybody stung and mad and of course not wanting to hurt David and Jillian, who can't wear protection?
Well, that wasn't one of my favorite experiences, because I like it when humans control the set.
Some of us initially chose to sort of, you know, stand up to our actors or stand up with them and not wear protective gearing. Well, I think Once Danny got stung, that all came to a close, and all the head nets came on, and the gloves and the off spray came on in layers.
Our clothes were glued to us at the wrists, along the collars, and I hadn't really thought about it that much. I knew that it was going to take place, and it was just going to be something. You know, that day, everything was about bees. All the shots we did before we shot with bees were about bees and pretending that we were being attacked by bees. And so finally, I was like, all right, already, bring out the bees. So David and I are standing on our marks. I'm waiting for the guys to come out with these big tubs of bees, and okay, here come the bees, and they start scooping, like with big rice scoops, the bees up into the air, and just seeing it for the first time, the thousands and thousands of bees. Well, David and I just looked at each other, and we both started going, oh my God.
We had to run through them, and you know, the guy, the head bee guy, who seemed a little odd to me, he was telling me that, you know, they're not gonna sting because of some pheromone or something, and I took him at his word. I guess you have to, but I really didn't quite believe him.
There was one moment, though, when I got a little nervous, because you're not supposed to pat your clothes at all, just in case there's one stuck in the folds, and if you pat it, then the bee is likely to sting you out of trying to protect itself. And there was one moment when the bee man, the bee doctor, was throwing, for a close-up when I'm running through the bees, he was throwing
hundreds of bees on top of me as I'm running. And I noticed at one point that there were a whole bunch of them around my wrist. And seconds later, David, you know, comes in to come back to get me, to grab me, and he grabs me right on my wrist. And I'm thinking, there's bees under there.
She gets stung?
I don't think so.
For the film's score, Chris Carter once again turned to the man responsible for all of the music on the TV series, Mark Snow.
That's really a gas here because there's going to be an 85-piece orchestra playing the film score. So this is the first time when that theme has sort of grown and become musical.
It was really interesting to see Mark finally, instead of sitting in his studio with his synthesizer, to be up in front of that 85-piece orchestra conducting them, and it just blew me away.
Chris Carter wanted very minimal approach, not much melody whatsoever, just ambient, atmospheric sound design, and he wanted a lot of it.
And so we talked about how the music would not be melodic and how it would be atmospheric and discordant and minor key stuff.
Some of what I call the cliche X-File electronic sounds mixed in with this big orchestra, it gives it this great sense of scope and grandeur and bigness that everyone is trying to achieve.
It does sound like a great big movie, and it's romantic, and it's exciting, and it's thrilling, and it's epic, and it's intimate, and we did it.
Appreciate it.
The X-Files movie. Questions answered, new questions posed, and the chance to experience Chris Carter's creation multiplied by X. I'm Mitch Pileggi. Thank you for joining us.